Hey, it's Friday night in East Lansing. Jim Comproni, SpartanMag.com. It's time for Spartan Mag Live. Let me know how we're doing with the audio. If it's any better this time, it's our second time around giving it a shot. SpartanMag.com. It is the online community for Michigan State sports. Hope we get some people. It's better. All right, getting some thumbs up now about the video or about the audio. Not sure why that happens. The USB on this side gets a little bit flaky sometimes, and it's good to see Rob South filing in and some of our subscribers, some of our loyal maggers. Good to have them here on a Friday night. Gather around, grab a beverage. Let me know what refreshments you're choosing tonight. We'll be talking Michigan State football and basketball. What we do, I'm publisher of SpartanMag.com, if you're not familiar. We take questions on Michigan State sports over at the Underground Bunker message board, which is part of the SpartanMag.com website, the best online community of Michigan State fans known to mankind in the history of mankind. We take those questions and answer those questions mailbag style here. Also, we invite our listeners to post some questions. We will get to those in the chat area as well. Looks like we've got some Oberon partakers out there. We certainly condone and support that. Made in Michigan, right? So we'll be talking a little bit about just a little bit of basketball recruiting maybe. And a little bit of football recruiting look into the weekend, but basically some overview football questions, some of the questions that were posted a few days ago, went back and got some that had some shelf life to them. Maybe going to cut it off at maybe 7 or 8 questions to try to keep this a little bit shorter. We'll get to some news and we'll get to some of your questions as well. We appreciate all you guys checking in, keeping an eye on the draft while you maybe talk some Michigan State sports. It's always talking season. It's always football season. Offseason is going to be 9 months. Usually it's a 9-month offseason this year. Maybe it's going to be 15 months. We don't know, but you guys are already always up for offseason talk, hot stove league style. That's what we'll talk about right now. We'll go to question number one, then maybe hit on some news here a little bit. Question number one from Grand Rapids. Hayden V8 says, and some of this pertains to the draft a little bit. It says, it seems like football in the Big Ten is as strong as ever on paper, looking even stronger in the future with Mel Tucker being hired and Schiano back at Rutgers, Fleck at Minnesota, Indiana and Purdue both trending upwards. Do you agree that the Big Ten is trending upward? And what is your opinion of the outlook of Big Ten football? That's from Hayden in Grand Rapids. Big Ten football, Ohio State, it's been the strength, been the power for a long time. Everybody knows that. And right now, it looks like Ohio State is just taking off and running. The gap is growing wider. If you look at what they're doing recruiting-wise, the recruiting power they have, the recruiting pull they have, in comparison to some of the like programs in the Big Ten, Michigan and Penn State are the programs most similar to Ohio State in terms of football resources. But Ohio State, all that those programs are seeing right now is taillights in terms of recruiting pull. And Penn State recruited well a couple years ago. Michigan has recruited well in, they always recruit well. Last couple years, not as good as maybe Rich Rod and Hoke recruited. People could dispute that rankings-wise. I'm not sure. But if you look at the draft, what Ohio State does comparison to Michigan, what Ohio State's bringing in right now, their ability to go out and get, 15 commitments and, 10 top 100s right now, whatever it is. Meanwhile, Michigan, I think they've got 2 4-star recruits right now. They're both offensive linemen. Offensive linemen, to some extent, almost all of them are projects, right? John L. Smith once said that. I thought about it for a few years, and I grew to agree with him on that. If you've got 2 4-star commitments right now and they're offensive linemen, okay, I've not looked at the film of the offensive lineman from Dearborn who committed to Michigan. I'm sure he's good, but not quite what Ohio State's doing, right? I'm sure Michigan will fill in later and do well, but Ohio State getting first pick on the playground right now in the Midwest and going and picking and choosing across the country as well. So the gap there, I think, is growing wider, and that's no big news flash there. So I agree that the Big Ten is getting stronger with in terms of 2 through 13. I think Maryland is not, they recruited okay with Loxley last year, I guess, but I'm not really sure where that program is headed in the short term. I agree with you that Rutgers is on the way up. I think Purdue is sound. Didn't have a great year last year, but they're going to be getting the most out of what they bring in. Indiana is recruiting interestingly, going down to Florida, getting a four-star here and there in Florida in recent years. Penix going down to Florida, beating Florida State for Penix. Interesting. The talent level at Indiana has crept up a little bit. They're getting good coaching. They've been pretty solid there in the Big Ten East. Michigan State and Northwestern have been a little bit down. Northwestern really struggled this year coming into the season with the quarterback situation. You know what happened there. Michigan State coming off a pair of 7-6 seasons. So Michigan State and Northwestern have not been in the last 24 months what they were maybe previously. So while those two have teetered a little bit, yeah, Minnesota's up there. Minnesota beating Auburn. Beautiful win for them during the bowl game. So you have Ohio State. You guys know this. You have Ohio State way up there. And then a pretty solid pack. That pack, especially the bottom half of the Big Ten, is good. Would I say it's as good as it's been in a long time? Maybe so. Remember, it wasn't that long ago when people would rip on the Big Ten for losing bowl games and not being able to compete with the SEC at all. But you look back, I know it's just three bowl games. Michigan got clobbered by Alabama in the second half. We saw that. Minnesota upset Auburn. Did I say Auburn or Alabama? Michigan lost to Alabama. Minnesota beat Auburn. Surprise. And Indiana was beating Tennessee the entire game and kind of flubbed it up at the end. Yeah, Tennessee won the game. SEC goes 2-1 against the Big Ten again. But there's usually like one SEC comfortable win, and then the rest of them are tight. More tight than you would expect based on everything we've heard coming out of the first round of the NFL draft with what the SEC, 15 of the 32 selections, 15 of the 32 first rounders from the SEC, six of the top 10. No question, the top end talent there is great. And no question, when you talk national championships, it's Alabama, then recent year, last year, LSU, Georgia, Auburn's been in there a little bit, Florida's on the way up. In terms of national championship contention, they've got more of those than the Big Ten. Big Ten's got one in Ohio State until further notice. I don't see Penn State or Michigan gaining any more traction right now than they've had in the last two or three years. I don't see them closing any of the distance there. Then Ohio State is the one team that's got a quarterback coming back this year. Fields, the best quarterback in the Big Ten. So the rich are just going to get richer as far as Ohio State is concerned. You know, Alabama, I talked about this on the message board at the Underground Bunker. When LSU played Alabama this year, there were 9 first-round draft choices on the field. LSU had 5 last night. As we record this, Alabama had 4. And a couple more could have gotten in there, but 9 first-round draft choices when they were on the field when they played this season. Now, there are probably some underclassmen that will be first-round draft choices next year from those schools. So 9 first-rounders. I'll venture to say probably 13 first-round draft choices were on the field when LSU played Alabama this year. 13 first-round draft choices. Now, you tell me, in a general regular season NFL football game, how many first-round draft choices are on the field? When the Lions played the Buccaneers on December 15th last year, how many first-round draft choices were on the field? 6 or 7? Not as many as were on the field when LSU played Alabama. I know they were younger when they played for LSU and Alabama, but still, the talent level. SEC, no question. At the top, everybody knows that. But you take a third-place Big Ten team against a third-place SEC team, a fifth-place against a fifth-place, you've seen what happens. I think it's competitive. Why is the SEC great? That could be talked about for ages. But basically, the talent's down there. Football's more important down there for the colleges. They spent more money to hire good coaches. They put more money into the programs, by and large. There's more talent down there. High school football is bigger down there, so they're going to stay closer to home. So that's why, and I think the Big Ten does a pretty good job being competitive when they have a chance to go against the SEC. So your question is the Big Ten as strong as ever on paper? No, I mean, not as strong as ever. As strong as it's been, stronger than it was 10 years ago, I would say, in comparison to the others. Because I think the Big Ten is better than the ACC, better than the Big 12. 6 years ago, you could have argued the ACC was right there with the Big Ten. Now Big Ten is easily number 2. Pac-12 is a few laps down. Then when you throw the basketball piece in there, combine football and basketball, which conference is the best? It's the Big Ten for those two sports. I love college baseball. Not going to talk about that as a Big Ten strength, although some of it is pretty good, and I'm missing it right now, as a matter of fact. Now, as far as news goes around Michigan State, of course, Michigan State commitment, Pierre Brooks on Wednesday. Power wing from Detroit Douglas, nice addition, good attitude, a 4-year type of guy, I would think, 4-year athlete. As far as an athlete goes, you know, I would compare him somewhere between. I compared him a little bit. People have compared him to Denzel a little bit and Alan Anderson. His shoulder structure a little bit. I think he's beefier than those guys were. He's hit the weights hard. Worked on his game. Nice shot. You guys have probably seen all that. I've compared him to Trevon Blewett a little bit. Blewett is a guy that went to Xavier, had a really good career. Michigan State recruited him pretty hard. Blewett had a little more pure, you know, that pure sneaky scoring ability, and he was a top 40 recruit. Brooks could get there, but a little less of that, but more than someone like Javon Bess. Remember Javon Bess came to Michigan State from Columbus, Ohio a few years ago, lasted a year or two, 6'5", was probably headed toward being an undersized four at Michigan State. Good athlete, not a great athlete. Some skill, not a lot of skill. All right, Brooks, better athlete, better skill than that. Not quite where Blewett is. So somewhere between Blewett and Bess, I think, is where Brooks is, and he's adding to his game all the time. Not going to be any drama. Not a guy like Jalen Terry that's going to be decommitting in 6 months. Not a guy that's going to be listening to people and making strange decisions about transfers, because transfer protection is something that's going to be part of roster management in the future. This guy checks those boxes. Everybody knows Bufkin is good at Grand Rapids, but Michigan State looked at it, saw that Brooks was a guy that wanted to make a decision right now rather than waiting and seeing. Michigan State talked to him, said, if you want to commit right now, we will take you. He wanted to. They took him. That one's done. So now Bufkin, are they still in it with him? I've been trying to do some research to find out a little bit more about what Michigan State is doing with Bufkin now and Kareem Mané and where that all adds up. Maybe we'll get some questions about that tonight. Nothing conclusive from what I've heard so far. I've got some feelers out there. And over the final forum message board at SpartanMag.com, we will chime in with that information when it comes down in terms of what Michigan State's approach is to Max Christie, to Bufkin, how they feel about Mané. Nothing new right now about that. Although with Mané, the kid from Montreal, indications are that there's more indications now that he might be heading toward the professional ranks. And I wonder if that had something to do with Michigan State having a virtual visit with Bufkin. Oh, you know, because that'll open up a scholarship. Well, a scholarship that they had reserved for Mané in case they got Mané. Well, they're not going to get him now, it's looking like. So that one springs open. Do they wait with Christie and Bufkin? These are big war room decisions. A lot of them are close to the vest. In some ways, they're not going to let people know what's going on because they've got competitors out there, namely the University of Michigan. They're not going to want some of that confidential information to get out. Let's take another question. We'll get back to some other news items in a moment. Question number two from Maul, South Philadelphia, born and raised. He says, which Michigan State player? Okay, this is a long question. This is a deep question, and we'll invite you guys to chime in with some of your answers on this one. Maul asks, which MSU player from 2000 up to now was I most shocked with that had a long professional career, whether it be the NBA or the NFL? Likewise, with whom were you shocked that didn't make it in the NFL or NBA? Talking about Michigan State people, who made it big in the NBA and NFL that surprised me, and who didn't make it in the NBA and NFL that surprised me? I got to say, I didn't anticipate Draymond Green becoming an Olympian and a world champion. Really turned himself, obviously, into an excellent college basketball player at Michigan State, great leader. I didn't anticipate him being one of the stars that stirred the drink for some great Golden State Warriors teams. And the triple doubles, he performed defensive player of the year in the NBA, I think he was. When he was in college, he was more of an optional defensive player. I mean, he directed traffic a lot, but was going to conserve energy on the defensive end in order to put more out on the offensive end. So I didn't anticipate Draymond Green as a second rounder becoming a type of guy that's a front line pitch man for Beats by Dre and the like. So great job, Draymond Green. Surprised by Bryn Forbes. When Bryn Forbes came to Michigan State, I remember talking to Carlton Valentine. So, you know, do you think he can play here? He's like, do I think he can play here? He goes, I'm not going to give you a quote about what I think he can do here. Carlton had a good idea what Forbes could do. Obviously can shoot it like crazy. World-class shooter. I remember watching him in the high school finals and wondering, you know, hearing he was going to Cleveland State and, you know, looking at that guy and saying, I wonder, you know, could he play in the Big Ten? You know, he was slight back then. He was slight. Interestingly, I remember watching like the state quarterfinals over the Don Johnson Fieldhouse in Lansing. That Lansing Sexton team that Carlton Valentine coached, that Denzel Valentine was on and Bryn Forbes was on. Draymond Green had just finished at Michigan State, or it was during his season, and he was there watching. And Draymond Green, you know, he's a student of the game. He's a basketball nut, right? And he's watching. He's watching. He's watching everybody. He's watching everybody. And I was sitting near him and one of the Michigan State coaches, probably Dwayne Stevens. And I didn't bother Draymond Green. He's sitting there. He's watching. He's watching intently. You know, there's some people that are just that are great basketball players, of course. And then there's those next level thinkers like Magic and Cleaves that just look at the game differently. And Draymond Green is in that category. And he's watching, not saying much. He's watching. He's watching. He's watching. Then the game's over and Sexton won by like 10 or 15 or something. And he looks over at Dwayne Stevens and he's like, they couldn't have beat us. They couldn't have beat us. They couldn't have beat us. And he talked about matchups and stuff. When he was talking about us, he was talking about his team from Saginaw and how great they were. And I think Draymond Green's team, did they beat the Keith Appling, Derek Nix team in the state finals at Breslin? So he was watching Sexton, the best in-state team in a few years, maybe the best team since his team. And he was watching to see whether his old team in Saginaw would have beaten Sexton. Competitive guy. That was his take on that one. Forbes on that team, transferred to Michigan State. He's a Lansing kid, transferred back to Michigan State. Thin, slight, could shoot it. Izzo, you know, Izzo gets that frustration going with somebody. And he loved some of the things Forbes could do, but his challenge with Forbes was toughening him up, not only adding some mass to him in the weight room, but getting him tough. Izzo was frustrated that Forbes was too soft for a long time. And he lost that softness, and then became an NBA player and starting for the Spurs. Is he starting? I think so. So Draymond Green doing what he's done, Bryn Forbes, those are the surprises basketball-wise. My surprise who didn't make it, I'm surprised Kalen Lucas hasn't stuck. And I know he had those injuries at Michigan State. And senior year was a disappointment, but the final 4 years, I mean, what was he, Big Ten? Was he Big Ten player in the year, player of the year as a sophomore? You know, just strength and electric quickness in high school, pull-up jumper game, good passer, not a great passer, good passer. You know, could score, do things. The injuries, you know. And it was hard to say whether, you know, how long it took him to get things right. Got back into the NBA for a couple 10-day contracts, I think it was. A little bit older. Spent some time living at Izzo's house, working on his game, coming back from injuries and so forth. You know, I think he could still maybe hook on here. Still has time. But some injuries and some other ill fortune. Otherwise, I think Lucas could have been an NBA type of player. Football-wise, who am I shocked who made it? You know, I look at someone like Garrett Celek. I mean, he started, what, 10 or 12 games at Michigan State? Was always a backup behind someone else that I'm going to mention as someone who I'm surprised didn't make it. But I'm surprised that Garrett Celek, as a free agent, 8 years with the San Francisco 49ers, all the same team. His most recent contract was like a $10 million contract and then retired just 2 months ago. Great career for Garrett Celek. When he was at Michigan State in 2011, his senior year, Garrett Celek, how many receptions did he have as a senior? Three catches as a senior. Garrett Celek, 14 career college receptions. 14. I know he went into the 49ers as a blocker. Harbaugh had a hand in drafting him. Made a nice career as a blocker, but he caught a lot more passes in just a handful of years in the NFL probably than he did in college. But Celek is the guy. Even though his brother was in the NFL and he was always compared to him, and I'm not really an expert on what his brother was because his brother played at Cincinnati, but Celek is the guy that surprised me that got in there and really made it in the NFL. Who surprised me from Michigan State since 2000 that they didn't make it in the NFL? I'd go with the guy that Celek played behind, Brian Linthicum. transferred from Clemson, right? Linthicum came. He was an athletic guy, 6'5", 245. 6'5", 245, playing for Kirk Cousins. Athletic down the field. Could really, you know, good hands, could threaten the seam. I'm not saying he could threaten the seam in the NFL, but if you could do that in the NFL, it seems like he could provide some possession skills to some NFL teams. I know you have to be able to block if you want to play attached tight end in the NFL. I thought he was an okay blocker, but he didn't make it. So maybe he didn't want it, or maybe he didn't have the blocking piece. But he was on the New York Jets practice squad in 2012. 6'5", 245. How many career catches did Linthicum have? 69. And he played right there with Celek. He had 69 receptions. Celek had 14. They both came out, I think, the same year as free agents. I kind of thought they'd both make it. I thought Linthicum was a guy who would get drafted. So, and Linthicum as a senior had 31 catches for a team that finished in the top 10. So those would be mine. Let me go ahead and send out a tweet here. I've got to find where I am here. I thought I had this saved up, but it's going to take me a little bit. Okay. Water. We're proud of that. I'll send that tweet out. I guess I'll send it out right now. Also, let's get to the question. I want to see what some of you have said in regards to that question that I just posed. Let me go up and look at that. All right, let's see what we've got here in the chat area. Hayden Vischer is with us from Grand Rapids. Good to see him from Grand Rapids. Rob South here as usual. He's got very good attendance here. The Untitled Beer Ranking Show, which I recommend everybody go check it out. Go to his site, check it out. It's a lot of fun, especially you beer drinkers. Hayden Vischer drinking Oberon, Michigan made. Got the draft on in the background. Untitled Beer Ranking Show, thanks for letting me post the episodes on the board and here. Did you see the shootout? I did not see the shootout. Old Tuck, the bell. Talking about bells, I imagine. Untitled Beer Ranking Show. Miller High Life. The champagne of beers. Old Tuck from Ludington. Comp, what's your take on Hogard. Is he a point guard? That's the kid originally from Pennsylvania, prep school now, signed with Michigan State. He'll be a freshman at Michigan State next year, basketball. He needs to tighten up his body a little bit. He's got a little bit of weight that he could shed and quicken up a little bit. I think that could help him become more of a lead guard. I don't know if he's a true point guard. Reminds me of like, now his vision, this is good. His vision and the way he plays the game a little bit, there's something about him that reminds me of a shorter Draymond Green a little bit. I know I said that about Cassius Winston too. And Hogard is not as much of a beautiful, pure, natural distributor that Winston was. I don't know if I use the word natural. I don't know if that's a good word, but Winston just had a feel for it. You know that. Hogard, you know, if he slims down, I think I like the way he sees the court and everything. Is he a point guard? He could play point. Is he a natural point? You know, there's points and there's natural points. Kalen Lucas had a point body and did well to distribute things. Maybe not a pure point. They're thinking Hogard can do it. He's going to have to do it a little bit of it next year. And, of course, Watts is going to have to as well. I think Watts will be up for it because at the next level, he's going to have the ball in his hands a lot more than he did this past year. So I think he'll be up for it. They'll probably wreck some satellites doing it, but eventually maybe they'll get to the moon. We'll see. Old Tuck asking if he's a David Hart type of guy. Would you watch your mouth, Old Tuck? Watch your mouth. I'll come over there. David Hart, no. Got a better feel than Hart. I mean, Hart, bless his heart, did his best, solid. Did some solid things in the early 90s. But, you know, David Hart couldn't shoot that well. Stiff. Quickness was so-so. That was at the end of the Heathcote era. But that's Old Tuck trying to be smart Alec. But we appreciate that. We don't mind that. Hayden Vischer. With Tucker's relentless recruiting approach, do you expect him to get a jump start on the 2022 class? I know 2021 just got rolling, but Coach D always seemed to focus on the upcoming class. Yeah, they've been sending out offers, as you've seen, to juniors. And yeah, I think they're going to run real strong with that group. You know, they're just trying to play catch up right now with the current juniors who are going to be 2021s. So the current sophomores, you know, Jaden Mangum and a lot of those guys. Offers are going out to 2022s. And right now, everybody's got an even playing field. You can't have virtual visits with sophomores right now. So you can't do that. But if they were able to do that, I think Michigan State would get an edge on some of these guys, because I think Michigan State's handling that part of it better than some of their Big Ten brethren. But yeah, they'll be getting in on juniors. It's too bad, like a lot of programs, they will not be able to have people come in for the summer camps. I'm trying to get to these questions about the NBA NFL question, but we'll get to some other ones here. I'll go ahead and maybe I'll get to those. I'll get to those later. Let's get back to question number three from the mailbag. Brad from Charlotte, North Carolina. Simple question here. He says, who puts the depth charts together as far as the positions groups go for a football Saturday? In other words, who decides if a running back gets a chance to carry the ball in a game, or a defensive back gets to go out there into coverage or on the defensive line rotation? Who decides these things? He says, is this done in coaching meetings with the entire staff, the coordinator, or the position coach? Answer is combination of position coach and coordinator. Position coach can tell you coming out of a week of practice who's number one. But if the coordinator doesn't agree and he thinks someone else should get the majority of the carries, that's what they'll go with. So yeah, it's the position coach gives a strong recommendation. That's the way it's been for Michigan State over the years. I would imagine that's the way it is with most teams. That's Brad's first question. Appreciate that, from Charlotte, North Carolina. Question number four, Cool Rock from St. Louis, Missouri. He's talking about Spartan Mag operational questions, talking about SpartanMag.com and the work that's done over there. And I've got to mention, he's talking about Paul and Corey and those guys. Corey Robinson doing a great job covering recruiting. We appreciate the heck out of him. Paul Konerdyke, always a great job. Appreciate him for a long time for Spartan Magazine and SpartanMag.com. All those guys doing a great job. The moderators, Andy and James and those guys, Ohio Spartan. Couldn't do it without those guys. They're a big part of what's going on at SpartanMag.com. The website's been rolling real strong through these trying times that we're going through. And it's been a lot of fun. I mean, we've not lost any traction. A lot of subscribers hanging in there with us. It's been a great place to go for sounding board and to compare notes on some things. But at the heart of it, you're all Michigan State fans, college football fans, and you're used to, at this time of year, after the spring game, just talking football, talking season. It'll be talking season right up to September 1st. Will it be talking season all the way to January 1st? We'll have to wait and see on that. Hoping that here in the next 4 or 5 weeks that there's a lot of positive changes that happen. I don't know what's going to happen, but that's a possibility. Cool Rock from St. Louis says, you guys at SpartanMag.com crank out a lot of content with a small staff and do a great job. Thank you. He says, I'm curious, are you and Paul exclusively your own editors and proofreaders, or do you exchange stories and provide feedback? If you do review each other's work, do you go as far as weighing in on stylistic stuff, or is that off limits? And he says, writing in while sheltered in place in St. Louis. You know, we edit each other's stuff. We post stuff without it being edited, and sometimes you can see that. You know, we try to get stuff up as quickly as possible. If I see that Paul or Corey posted something, I'll go in and proofread it. When I write something, it doesn't really get proofread. I might get an email from somebody that says, hey, man, you had a typo about something. Or I mean, you've seen it. I've done some things that, you know, I might say that somebody was a graduate of 1998 Michigan State, and I might write it as 1898. And of course, that's not going to be true. But every writer needs an editor. Even guys like that. Even dudes like that need editors. He did a lot of his thinking and initial thoughts up here. And certainly I need an editor. And I don't always get edited. I try to take extra time to look through it, but you can never catch your own mistakes. So You're right. We don't have a big staff. We don't have copy editors back at some headquarter location overlooking stuff. We do the best that we can. You know, and on the message board, I'll look to see. Sometimes you guys will catch something and let me know. But for the most part, we publish our own stories. I'll look over those, but nobody overlooks mine. And it's not always pretty, but we have fun with it. And the reaction we get is pretty good, and we appreciate the people that read our stuff. And in today's media, yeah, we have traditional news-style articles, and then we've got editorials, analytical pieces, opinion pieces, and then some news articles that flex between news and opinion, which I think there's a thirst for that. I think there's an appreciation for that. The people that want to know what the news is, but also what you think about it along the way. We'll toggle that a little bit. You know, in journalism school, you're supposed to write a news piece and not put your opinion in that at all. I've morphed away from that a little bit. Paul, if you think something, you have an opinion, put your opinion in there. Ricardo Cooney, put your opinion in there. Sometimes it's just raw opinion as an analytical piece, and you can see that as a different way to do it also. But also, you know, part of the media, new media is what it was called 7-8 years ago. Now there's social media. I'm not talking about social media, but new media to me, our message board, the Underground Bunker message board at SpartanMag.com, new media to me, you know, we're at a press conference. We'll post on there some of the things that are happening during the press conference. Some of that stuff is on Twitter also. We'll try to throw some analysis in there. And then, of course, it becomes a conversation between the subscribers who are very astute Michigan State fans and some of our writers. A lot of cases, we will take cues from some of the readers because some of the readers are so sharp. Some of their opinions, I'm like, man, I never thought about it that way. It might even spur on some story ideas for us. But we wrote an article about Tressel and Ron Burton. They had a teleconference on Wednesday. I wrote an article about Burton and Tressel and what they think of Mel Tucker. I thought that was interesting. Now, some of that was, you know, some very complimentary things were being said by these two guys about their current boss, understandably. But I thought that readers would find it interesting. People that you know, you've been listening to Burton and Tressel a lot over the years, and you know how they talk, sometimes a little understated. But I thought that it was interesting that they were not understated at all, talking about Tucker and how he has kept them on their toes recruiting-wise. And, you know, Tressel saying that Tucker says that nobody's going to out-recruit Michigan State, or not, no one's going to outwork them. These are things you've never heard Tressel say. I thought that was interesting, eyebrow-raising, and I figured that you guys as readers could arrive at that without me pointing it out. So I wrote it as a news story instead of stopping and making it an editorial. Now, here's the thing. In that story, during that interview, Burton and Tressel both said interesting things about recruiting and Tucker's recruiting. I didn't put that into the story, but I thought those were two big power quotes. So on the Underground Bunker message board, I wrote power quote by Mike Tressel, and it was the quote about him talking about recruiting, and Burton too. It was not in a story. It was just raw quote that we put out there for you on the message board. To me, that's new media. That's an example of new media. It didn't go with a story, probably putting it together with a story for later with some other quotes from Kapilovic and some others about recruiting. But I didn't have it in a story at that time. It was 3 in the morning. I was 4 in the morning. I was getting ready to go to bed. I was done for the day. I was like, I want to get this quote out there for the people right now because it's pertinent. It's interesting. Boom. Message board. People talked about it. So that's a form of new media. Wrote a story, and then threw something on the message board. I've got the audio of those interviews. We'll probably try those out later. Later in the late spring, some of those, depending on how much access we get with other things later. But I want to let those stew for a while because there's a lot of good writers that participate in those teleconferences. I want to make sure that they have a chance to use their quotes and write their stories because sometimes they ask really good questions that pertain to their story. Let them write their story and get that out there, and then later on we'll come through with the audio. That's my viewpoint on that right now. That could change depending on how much the audio is used elsewhere. But these are editorial decisions, and it's morphing all the time. Appreciate the question. As far as along those lines, I want to talk about some other news tidbits pertaining to the Tressel-Burton interviews. One of the more interesting, I thought, it's a deep depth chart type of point. But I asked Mike Tressel the very last question. I said, because he was talking about safeties. He's coaching safeties now. And he was talking about some of the players that are coming along, Michael Dowell being one, and Trey Person. Of course, Xavier Henderson's going to be a starter, we would imagine. You know, Michael Dowell, and I can't remember who the other safety was, but he did not mention Dominique Long. So I had heard that Dominique Long had been penciled in as a corner for the outset of spring practice. Spring practice that never took place, obviously. So I'm just looking up the depth chart to see who that other safety was. Tate Halleck was the other one. So Tate Halleck and Michael Dowell. He didn't mention Long, and I'd heard that Long was maybe going to be playing corner. So I asked him, I said, well, I didn't say I've been hearing, but I said there's been indications that Dominique Long, who's been corner and then safety and played at safety for a while, you know, 6'1 and a half, one of the faster guys on the team, excellent in coverage on special teams, excellent straight line speed, Westerville, Ohio, I think, but he's never quite broken into the playing group. You know, briefly maybe in dime, one or two games in the last 3 years, but not much. Hasn't really earned that trust. He's got a frame like a safety, but I'd heard that he'd been moved experimentally, but he's, you know, he's getting to be a junior or a senior now. I think he's going to be a senior his next season, this season coming up, whenever that season is. I asked Tressel, you didn't mention Long. There's been indications that he might be moving to corner. Can you expand on that a little bit? Is that true? And he said, yeah, you know, he kind of indicated that that was true, that Long has been moved, penciled in at corner. I thought that that was an interesting little news item coming out of that, and that confirmed what I had heard going into spring practice, that Dominique Long, with Harlan Barnett coming in, they wanted to take a look at Dominique Long at corner. So that was interesting news this week. I mentioned that on the message board, did not put it into a story yet. Might put that into a story for tomorrow or the next day. But at corner, you've got Shakur Brown, Kalen Gervin. You've got Davion Williams and Dominique Long. I heard Davion Williams, sophomore, true sophomore? From Belleville. Davion Williams, Dominique Long. A couple of guys with a lot of juice. Got a frame and they can run. But now, second string corners. You bring Harlan Barnett in to teach those guys. Could be interesting to see if those guys all of a sudden take a different tack on their ability. Reminds me of the kid from the transfer from South Carolina that transferred here for John L. Smith. Didn't play at all his first year. Then the next year, D'Antonio and Barnett comes in. They come in, and boom, he's a starter. Boom, he's good. Was it Jeremy Ware? Was that his name? Gets drafted by the Raiders. So he went from like not in the playing group in 06 for John L. Smith to the next year being an NFL draft pick. Devin Thomas also did the same thing as a wide receiver, a junior college transfer. Ware, right? Detroit Spartan cluing me in on that one. Jeremy Ware, right? So Barnett making a big difference with those guys. Can Barnett come in and make a big difference with Dominique Long and Davion Williams? He knew Davion Williams through his recruitment, but left when Davion was on his way in, maybe the year after. But he had a hand in recruiting Dominique Long out of Ohio way back when. So now Barnett wants to get his hands on him. Corner, an interesting little subtle news nugget this week. But those of you that are big Michigan State football fans, you want to know what's going on in the first string, the second string, the third string, walk-ons, junior recruiting, senior recruiting, sophomore recruiting. You guys want to know the whole picture. That's the difference between big college football fans and NFL fans. I got respect for NFL fans, but your average NFL fan, or let's say a good NFL fan, can he name everybody on the second string? I mean, you're only carrying 44 guys, right? So I guess you would be able to name those. But people are coming and going and waivers and different starters and 16-game schedule and people getting hurt and other guys coming in off the taxi squad. Do you really know who David Blau was before the season started? If you're a Lions fan, you might not even know you're starting 22 if you're a good NFL fan. I don't know. I certainly don't. I follow the Lions, but I don't know who all the 22 are. It's hard to keep track of it. I certainly don't know the backups, and there is no third string. There's a taxi squad, but you don't know who they are because you're not developing from there. In college, 2 years from now, the starters are the current third stringers. That's the way it should be. So that's why college fans are interested in the third stringers. Any third stringers on the rise? Well, Davion Williams is one to keep an eye on. there at corner. It's one of the beautiful things about college football. As far as the depth chart goes, I just mentioned, you know, Dominique Long and Davion Williams. I did the Athlon's preview for Michigan State, the Michigan State page for Athlon's, and they asked for a depth chart, the forecast. I put one together. They just wanted a forecast. I mean, not many people in the country had special teams to look at. Most teams didn't put out a depth chart. Michigan State certainly did not. Mel Tucker hasn't been on the practice field with these guys. He's not going to put out a depth chart. I put one out, had to, and heard those things about corner. Kind of wanted to verify that with Tressel, and it did get verified. But who are my starters in the defensive backfield? I got Shakur Brown and Kalen Gervin. In the safeties, Xavier Henderson, Trey Person. No surprises there. Kalen Gervin started the one game at Ohio State, struggled. He's going to need to prove some more. Somebody's going to have to get some traction there at the corner position. I had Kalen Gervin's forecast projected starter at corner. The other ones, you know, based on what I heard, Dominique Long and Davion Williams are the corners, second string corners. Christian Jackson, could he have been in there? Maybe. I chose to go with those two guys. Might end up being wrong about that, but there's not a lot of them. There's not a lot of DBs to choose from really right now in terms of proven players. The safeties, Michael Dowell and Tate Halleck. Tate Halleck did some good things at special teams, impressed some people, won some respect, played four games, shut it down, preserved the red shirt. That's what I had for the safeties. And maybe I'll have that depth chart and put it out on the bunker in the days ahead. So, you know, that was some of the news going on this week. You had the Pierre Brooks. You had the Mike Tressel thing I thought was an interesting news nugget. Let's go back to the mailbag real quickly here. All right, this is from Mall 286 from Bolingbrook, Illinois. He's the other guy from South Philadelphia. Same guy. Two questions from him. Usually we don't do that, but I guess we did this time. He said, all right, this is another long-ranging historical question. Which early departure for Michigan State basketball was the most shocking to you? Cotton, Lorbeck, Taylor, other? Who would I pick on that one? I think, you know, Lorbeck was shocking because he just was just here for 1 year, you know, freshman. Cotton was a guy that, you know, one of those situations when you talk about hearing people that are in someone's ear, Izzo was always wary about people being in the ear of his players and trying to carve them out and get them to transfer elsewhere. And he was always worried about that. He was worried about that with several players that ended up staying. It's just one of his natural paranoias, right? It's a defense mechanism. I don't blame him for it. Well, Cotton was one guy that people were able to get in his ear and bring him out. And he was a strong guy. And he did some good things at University of Detroit. And I wonder how he could have done at Michigan State. That would have been... He would have been a teammate of, in the, you know, that if he'd have hung around, he would have been, was it after Marcus Taylor? So that era around 02 when Marcus Taylor was a sophomore, going into 03 when Chris Hill began the season as a point guard, not a true point guard, struggled there. By the end of the year, freshman Drew Neitzel became a starter. No, that was 05 when Hill was playing point guard. I might be getting it wrong. 03. Alan Anderson moved to the point, replaced Chris Hill. That's what it was. And they went to the Elite Eight. So, I mean, Cotton would have been the point guard at that time. Cotton, yeah, Shannon Brown class. Thanks, Detroit Spartan. Yeah, Shannon Brown, Brandon Cotton, that's a lot of horsepower there. And I don't know what Brandon Cotton's doing these days. I wish him the best. But, yeah, you know, that was a disappointment. And that was just one of those, that was a tough situation. I think I talked about that here a few weeks ago. But those were all disappointing ones. You know, Lorbeck was only here 1 year and really came on strong at the end of the year. I think he may have led Michigan State in scoring in the NCAA tournament in 2003 when Michigan State made a surprise run to the Elite Eight. Stretch four, hitting three-pointers from the corner. Very good skill. I mean, some people were comparing him to a Euro, you know, Nowitzki type of game. As many of you know, his dad was a general manager in the professional ranks over in Europe. And had him over here for 1 year of college basketball, was going back home, and he had a two-way ticket. The plane ride, everything was set up for him to come back. And Izzo, like, I don't know if he spoke with him and Lorbeck's dad. Did Lorbeck's dad may have even been here to go home with him or something, but they looked Izzo in the eye and said, yes, he will be back. And he never came back. And he would have been a standout college basketball player. You think about 2004 and 05. Paul Davis was a very good player, but Davis had to play so much back to the basket. I thought Paul Davis had the ability, good ball handler, good shooter, never got to see him shoot many three-pointers. I thought Paul Davis had stretch four talent and never really had a chance to play the stretch four. He didn't have much help around him. He had to go down low and play in the post a lot. Some of the offense threw him back to the basket-wise. He was good. Paul Davis was 2,000 points, 1,000 rebounds or something like that. He's in the top five in both top 10 in both categories at Michigan State all time. He's got some really big numbers, but I think he could have even been better if he had been surrounded by another big man. Now, Lorbeck was more of a pure stretch four than Davis was, but if Davis had been surrounded by somebody that could play some of the five and he could space out, I think Davis could have had more memorable moments in his career. And see, when Davis was playing, he was always worried about getting in foul trouble, because if he got two fouls, he was coming out. But not only that, but when he went out, the drop-off was immense, because his tag team partners were Delco Rowley, you know, Jason Andreas, I think, you know, guys that were trying to get traction but never, you know, were always battling injuries and other ailments. You know, Matt Trannan would join the team halfway through the year coming from football. So Davis didn't have any tag team partners down there, and they needed him to not get in foul trouble, and that affected his game. So Davis had a lot of talent to be an excellent college football player, but never really got to really show all of his talent, in my opinion, because of people that left. Now, Lorbeck, if they would have had him, what could things have been different in 04 or 05 even? Man. So Lorbeck is the one that was the most shocking. Taylor was shocking too, though, because sophomore, he led the Big Ten in, Marcus Taylor talking about, in 02, led the Big Ten in scoring and assists. Very rare. Scoring and assists. And then in 02, you had Taylor as a sophomore, and then the three freshmen were in, Torbert, Anderson, Hill. That team only went about six or seven deep, got in the tournament, one and done against North Carolina State, lost a nine-point lead. So Taylor, when Michigan State was losing to North Carolina State after they lost first-round game, Washington, D.C., walking off the court, Izzo and Taylor, and I'm walking off the court just a couple steps behind them, and Izzo's talking to Taylor, and they both are walking, and there's an Associated Press picture of both of those guys, and I'm kind of lurking in the background. And by the way, because I'm off to the side, it stretched me out, and I've got the width of Danny DeVito in that photo. It's a good look. So I'm watching Izzo and Marcus Taylor, and he's talking to him, and Taylor's like looking down and nodding, and Izzo's talking to him. So I asked Izzo after the game, I was like, hey, so what'd you say to Taylor walking off the court? And he said, I told him, are you going to help these freshmen grow up? Are you going to get on them to help these freshmen grow up? Talking about Anderson, Hill, and Torbert. Taylor's like, yeah, yeah. 3 weeks later, gone. NBA. Second round draft choice, didn't stick. He wasn't a great athlete. Good skill, but the ceiling potential was not great. And didn't turn out to be the happiest story basketball-wise. But yeah, Taylor was a surprise. Lorbeck was a surprise. Both guys weren't quite totally truthful with Izzo on that one. That's their prerogative. There's no law that says they have to be, but those were shocking. All right, so, and he also asks, which player were you most shocked that didn't pan out at Michigan State? So that's similar to the earlier question, and he says, Kyle Brown. Would he be in that category? And I'm like, Kyle Brown. I know Kyle Brown came in as a 3.5-star guy that ran well from suburban Detroit. And he didn't turn out to be all Big Ten and great or anything, but the guy had 88 career catches, 1,300 career reception yards. He was a good, solid contributor. And there was one game, like at Minnesota, was it in the Smith era, where I thought he picked the team up and carried them, and the win was his win. I can't remember if he played for D'Antonio or not, or if that was John L. Smith era. Now that season, if it was John L. Smith, the season didn't end up becoming anything, but they were in survival mode and needed a win, and things were going like they normally would. And Brown really came to the forefront when the chips were down in a tough situation on the road at Minnesota and showed some guts in that game. I don't know all the specifics, but that's just one of the, that's an earmark. Is that a word, earmark? That's a footnote that I remember from him. So, no, I would not put Kyle Brown in that category. So who's I shocked who didn't pan out? I would have expected more out of Eric Knott or Fred Smith. Fred Smith put on too much weight, came in from Detroit Southeastern, kind of ate his way out of the wide receiver position. Not quite physical enough or the right mindset to be a fullback or a tight end. They tried him at fullback. And he went deep on a bluff route once. That's all you could do with him as a fullback because you couldn't use him at fullback on a regular basis because he wasn't going to block like you need a fullback to block. Sneak him on the field, put him in a fullback matchup. You might get him on a linebacker. They tried it once, but he didn't quite pan out. Eric Knott, I could tell a story about that one. And, you know, last week I told you I was watching that PSL semifinal game. Detroit King against, was it Southeastern? No, Detroit Henry Ford with Damon Dowdell and Eric Knott against what, Shazor and Vickerson and those guys. And I was watching Knott out there. Man, he was a nice-looking specimen. He was ranked high as a tight end. You guys remember that. There were some problems coming in. Got through it, whatever. But I'm not, you know, the Eric Knott thing. All right, I'll tell you this. And this involves some profanity. So if you're with your kids driving or something, I'm going to say a bad word in a minute. Mostly our podcast are profanity-free, and we're proud of that. We try to be that way. I listen to so many podcasts these days, and there's just so much loose profanity. I don't like that. Now, in real world, I'll use words like that, but to me, I just sounds scuzzy and juvenile, and not going to do it, but I will say a bad word here in a minute. So John L. Smith had just been hired, and I had a one-on-one with him in his office. So you're asking about I'm asking about this player and that player, and Eric Knott had come in under Bobby Williams and was a little slow getting on the field because of some off-field issues, and you know there was a lot of anticipation for what Eric Knott could possibly be, and maybe John L. Smith had already coached 1 year, and Knott hadn't gotten on the field much. So I was asking John L. Smith about this guy and this guy and this guy, and I was like, and you know, what about Eric Knott? And John L. Smith didn't know me real well, but you know, sometimes guys are bothered about a player, and when they're asked about it, it comes out negative. So I said, you know, what about Eric Knott? And I'm sure that John L. Smith was being asked about Eric Knott at various alumni functions and donor functions because he's a guy that had a lot of publicity coming in and a lot of notoriety coming in. So he's probably sick of being asked about Eric Knott. And I said, John L., so, you know, I asked about this player and that player and that player. And I said, okay, how about, what about Eric Knott? And he may have thought that I was another one of these people saying, how come Eric Knott's on the field? He's one of the best players. And that's not what I was saying, but he may have thought that. And he didn't attack me, but he made it clear. And he didn't even say off the record. So I said, you know, how about Eric Knott? And John L. Smith says, Eric Knott, he's shitty. So that's my John L. Smith impression. Sorry about that. And Eric Knott, I think he finished his career at Michigan State. Had a couple of contributions here and there. And I mentioned it a couple weeks ago that he was kind of Vickerson's corner man a few times. But I wish Eric Knott well. But looking back at that semifinal game, and I didn't say that, Eric, if you're watching this, John L. said that. But Eric Knott was a specimen in high school. And that semifinal game was pretty cool. It's on YouTube. You can find it somewhere. All right. You know, and as far as other players, surprised that they didn't pan out. You know, in the D'Antonio era, I thought the running back Andre Anderson, remember that was Damian Anderson's brother, came in, did some things under John L. Smith, but then transferred out. Remember Michael Jordan, a defensive end, came in. I thought he had a lot of ability, never did much. Brendan Trawick is one. Trawick was a safety from Marietta, Georgia. They tried to turn him into a linebacker. And around that time, Trowick was involved in the Rather Hall incident. And I think his dad kind of caught wind that it seemed like a kangaroo court around here with some of the way some guys were getting the book thrown at them a little bit. And Trowick was there. So technically, he had one strike against him legally. If he'd have been my son, I probably would have yanked him out too. So he was on the next flight back to Georgia. Went to a directional school down south. Was it Troy State or something like that? Ended up in the NFL. So Trowick is a guy, I guess I'm surprised that they moved him to linebacker. I mean, Michigan State's done such a great job. D'Antonio and Barnett did such a great job recruiting and evaluating and developing defensive backs. D'Antonio's got a long list of defensive backs in the NFL, expecting Josiah Scott to be the last one. There could be others, I guess, that he had a hand in still in the next couple of years. But the fact that they were moving Trowick to linebacker was interesting because it's a guy that ended up having NFL DB talent, obviously, that they moved him. So that was one. You know, I mentioned Fred Smith. Donald Spencer was one. Donald Spencer was a four-star wide receiver. Ended up being like a three-star receiver, like 6'3" and a half from Ypsilanti. Came in as a wide receiver and was at camp, at Michigan State's camp, as a commitment. That was that same class with Edwin Baker and Larry Caper and those guys and Andrew Maxwell. Michigan State was off to a great start recruiting. Spencer was one of them. And Spencer looked good at wide receiver at camp, but there's this other dude with a gold helmet that was like just a little bit bigger. I know Spencer was supposed to be 6'3" and a half, but this other guy looked bigger and quicker and better hands even, you know, better build and just was just better than Spencer. And the dude came in without much fanfare and everybody had to go look on the list to see who it was. It was Benny Fowler. Benny Fowler had been, where was he, at Country Day? Fowler was in a single wing offense, played a lot of quarterback and never played much wide receiver. Showed up at camp and, you know, became an NFL receiver, became a really good one at Michigan State. But Spencer came in and there were other wide receivers and Fowler was there and some other guys were ahead of him. And after just 1 year or so, he got a little anxious, transferred out, went to a directional MAC school or something like that. And Donald Spencer, if he would have waited his turn, there was that time when, remember, around 2008 when Michigan State's wide receivers were just dropping passes left and right. You know, guys like, well, I mean, Mumphrey, NFL guy, was dropping passes. Fowler, NFL guy, was dropping passes. Everybody was just dropping passes. Tony Lippitt is dropping passes. And people were like, okay, who's going to be the wide receiver, take the bull by the horns, and be the guy? Well, that's where Spencer, if he had stayed course and waited his turn, he might have developed quicker than those guys. I don't know, or right with them. But he happened to come in with a great group of receivers. So it didn't end up hurting the program, but I thought Spencer had the ability if he'd have waited a little longer. You know, going back to the John L. Smith era, Pat Regan was a tight end from Traverse City. I thought he looked real good in camp and came in and looked good early. Had to retire because of a neck injury. There was a tight end from Poland, Ohio in 2004 named Dan McGarry. Dan McGarry. I remember talking, I think it was Dave Baldwin, the offensive coordinator at the time. He was talking about McGarry. And he said, yeah, you know, that guy's a no-brainer. Yeah, we offered him. He's big. He's got ability and all these things. I mean, McGarry came in and was in college for a month and left. You know, probably was on the field, the practice field. We never saw him on the field. And, of course, another one that was a four-star guy that Matt Dorsey and I talk about a lot, Carl Grimes out of Detroit DePorres, 5'9", smaller guy. Maybe a little bit stiff looking back, but quick and physically built, was ranked high. Michigan State, it was big that they got him. It was a big recruiting moment for John L. Smith and the new program. And John L. Smith compared him to Deion Branch, who he had at Louisville, that then was with the Patriots and was MVP of the Super Bowl. So in the recruiting pitch to Grimes, we think you're like Deion Branch. Deion Branch even called him. Grimes hung around for 2 or 3 years. Just never made that transition to college. So those would be the ones I'd go with there. So let me get back to the let me look back at the chat area for some of these questions. Tyler Simmons asking me who's the first player for Michigan State to be drafted. That's a great question. Who's going to be the first player to be drafted? We're recording this on Friday night. Saturday We anticipate Michigan State players to be selected. Kenny Willekes, maybe Joe Bocci, Josiah Scott, maybe Raekwon Williams. Those four. None of them are slam dunks to be picked at all. I guess Willekes probably is. But Josiah Scott is an acquired taste if you're an NFL guy. Excellent speed, good skill, ankle biter as a tackler. Not the biggest guy, but a slot corner type of guy. I'm assuming Scott's going to get drafted. A lot of people think it's going to be him or Willekes, but there's been some mock drafts that have Bocci going ahead of those guys. I'm not sure. My guess, I guess I'm going to go with Willekes is my guess. That's just not all that educated of a guess. Because I'm trying to guess what other people are guessing there. Because a draft is a guess, so I got to guess what they're guessing. And they don't give any indication. In the recruiting game, it's easier to guess what they're guessing because there's indications on who they're showing most interest in and or what's going on. In the draft, if they like a guy, if a program likes a guy, if an NFL team likes a guy, they're going to keep it quiet. So there are no indications, real indications. So anyway, I'll go with Willekes. Old Tuck says, Pierre Brooks compares to Dar Tucker. I think Tucker, you know, similar, I guess. Dar Tucker, kid from Saginaw that went to DePaul. Brooks a little bit taller, I think. Both of them are muscular. Dar Tucker was always muscular. Dar was maybe a little stiffer, maybe a little more juice. Interesting comparison, though. The Untitled Beer Ranking Show says Brooks could develop into a Jamal Crawford-type guy, depending on how well his handle improves. And Jamal Crawford was definitely a great ball handler. And he played for 100 years, right? Old Tuck says maybe a Malik Hairston. Old Tuck showing some old school basketball knowledge. Hairston, a smoother guy. Interesting comparison. Thanks for contributing. I'm not saying smoother better, but maybe softer than Pierre. Interesting, though. Doors fan 90, Malik Hairston from Detroit, what? Was he with Mark White? And went to Oregon with Joe Crawford. Anyway, what school was that? Anyway, Doors fan 91 says Blackwell aside, why did the old staff lose so much in-state credibility? Top kids wanted nothing to do with them last year and this year. I think Blackwell's part of it, and I think Michigan State got to the point where they didn't feel they had a defeatist attitude about what they could and couldn't do in Detroit, and in some ways didn't even bother to go in there. It had gotten to that point. So that's part of it. Now, did Michigan State also ramp down their recruiting intensity? I think so. I think they almost had, not all the coaches, but some of them almost developed a Judd Heathcote type of Detroit Renaissance. Thanks, Christian Trainum. Detroit Renaissance was really good there for a while with White as the coach, Malik Hairston, Joe Crawford, and someone else. Tough little point guard. Can't remember who it was. So I forgot what I was going to say. So, you know, a Judd Heathcote type of thing where Heathcote got to where he's like, well, I'm not going to beat these guys for those players, so I'm just going to go out and recruit who I recruit, and we'll bring in players, and we'll get the most out of them, and we'll get what we can out of them, and we'll win because we're good coaches, and we'll develop them. So I kind of think Michigan State kind of got into that mindset. We'll go into Ohio. We'll get our guys, and we'll be good. And the roster's not bad. It's thin in some areas, but it lost some juice. It lost some RPMs. It lost some horsepower in Detroit specifically. So I think it's a combination of the Blackwell thing and also a little bit of a defeatist mindset or a, I don't know if defeatist is the right word, but with Terry Samuel being the recruiter, the principal recruiter in Detroit, that was kind of off and on. So all of the above, different than what Michigan State's trying to get back to right now. Now, I think Michigan State's going to recruit better in terms of winning more recruiting battles now and getting more four stars, and we'll talk about that in a moment. That doesn't necessarily guarantee that they will get that will produce better college football players or better college football teams. The player development component, the quality control component, all those things are almost equal, but they are putting more emphasis on the grocery shopping, going in with the finest ingredients. They want to bring in what they think are the finest ingredients. And then I'm sure that they expect to do great with player development and quality control too. And if those are all working in this in concert and they start to win, and then Mel Tucker starts to recruit as a winner, I don't know. It could be an interesting evolution. I'm not sure how good Michigan State can be if all those things are ramped up. That could happen, and we'll all find out at the same time. So Hayden Vischer says Bufkin offered by Michigan tonight. Interesting. I did miss that. So, you know, that's what it comes down to with Bufkin. Michigan State had the virtual with him, trying to find out what went on there. But the way the dominoes work, once the Brooks domino went and Michigan had offered him, now that one's off the table. So if you're Michigan and you're looking, they hadn't offered Bufkin yet, and Bufkin likes Michigan, hadn't been offered. So if you're Michigan, makes sense to go ahead and offer now, because otherwise he could get away elsewhere, right? And a lot of times it's that one. Like Bufkin might not have had any intention of making a decision anytime soon, but once the first domino goes, they all go. We've seen that a number of times. Most recently, of course, Cassius Winston and Xavier Simpson. One went, then the other went. I mean, Simpson was waiting for a Michigan State offer. They got Winston. As soon as he did, he went to Michigan. That's the way the dominoes work, and I'm not surprised that's what's going on with Bufkin right now. It will be interesting if he goes ahead and takes that commitment to Michigan. I wouldn't be surprised if he does. It depends on what the communication was between Michigan State and Bufkin when they met yesterday, and I'm trying to find out more about that. It's very important. Doors fan for me, it's Alan Anderson, played a while in the NBA. That's you're talking about. That's the surprise guy. That's the person who surprises you, that he did that well. Well, he was team MVP in 05 for a team that went to the Final Four. And I would agree with you that I would have anticipated that he may have been a jack of all trades, master of none professionally, but that foundational layer of ball handling for Anderson really helped him. And then became a good shooter at the very end of his college career. And sure, yeah, he did play a while in the NBA. He had a good career in the NBA. Tyler Miller from Lansing says, who do you think is warming up to us for the next football commitment? Could it be Andrell Anthony? I don't think Anthony's in any hurry right now. Anthony, the excellent wide receiver from East Lansing. Michigan State's made some progress with him. Corey Robinson had a really good update on Anthony not long ago. Go to SpartanMag.com, check that out. In the meantime, give us a thumbs up here on this site if you have not already. Subscribe if you have not already. That helps us with algorithms get out to more Michigan State fans. So, who's the next commitment? You know, there's a solid chance. Keep an eye on this guy, Charles Brantley, the corner from Florida, Venice, Florida, I think it is, 6'1", 170. Rivals.com ranks him the number 36 player in Florida. We had the scoop on Underground Bunker message board a couple days ago that he is going to have a virtual visit with Michigan State on Saturday of this weekend. As you watch this, it might already be Sunday, but today's Friday. Tomorrow we're supposed to have a virtual visit. He's got offers from Florida State, Virginia, Louisville, Washington State, and some others. Michigan State offer. And related to Herb Haygood a little bit. Okay, Hayden Vischer with information. Thank you. It's moved to Tuesday. I missed the memo on that. Sometimes when I'm doing homework and watching video, and I watch some video of Brantley, sometimes when I'm detained by that, I miss other information elsewhere. And you guys are ahead of me on that sometimes. It's hard to stay informed while you're working, but we do our best. But thank you for chiming in on that. But Brantley, I might talk to Herb about that a little bit too, but I think Michigan State's in good position there. And I was watching his film. I've not watched all of it, but hands for a corner. You go watch his film, the way he's making some, the way he's high pointing it, making some grabs, making some deflection grabs, ball skills, you know, hitting, knocking it out, forcing fumbles, coming up with fumble recoveries. And, you know, I mean, the beginning of his highlight film is just takeaways, takeaways, takeaways. And then you see a kickoff return, and you see some juice from him in the kickoff return. And one time he's playing some zone coverage, comes in with a real big hit. So 6'1", 170, he can bring it. And I didn't watch all of it. I'd have to watch more. So I didn't really get a chance to really see the change of direction. The very first highlight of him, He's kind of off the screen a little bit, but it looks like he makes a really quick break on the ball. Really quick, like exceptionally quick. And I wanted to see it again, but it's hard to get a look at it. But I've not watched him enough to look at the hip turn and the change of direction and those things. But that other stuff, the hitting and the ball skills, frame, acceleration, it all looks pretty good. I would put him a little bit ahead of Antoine Booth right now in terms of what I think of them as a player. But I think Michigan State's got a good chance shot to get him. And that shouldn't be a surprise. This kid's a four-star, and I can see why he's a four-star. So Michigan State's got a shot at that guy. Harlan Barnett off and running down in Florida for Michigan State. So that's all for the news. I was going to include that as a news thing, a football recruiting news thing. But that goes to your question about who might be the next commitment. Let me get finished with the mailbag here, and then we'll go through the chat area, and we'll call it a Spartan Mag Live. And we'll try to get back to you inside of 7 days. Again, it was another 7-day wait. I want to knock these off a little more quickly. All right, MSU Pat from Parts Unknown says, Jim, given the COVID-19 restrictions, does this year's recruiting come down to how well coaches do with film analysis as much as anything else? With no camps, T-shirt, shorts, camps, and no circuit, T-shirt, circuit, the thought is many players will commit before the fall games due to the concern of spots being taken up. While the new staff appears to be watching more film than previous staff and putting out more offers, do we have any feel how well they can evaluate players, relatively speaking? No, we won't be able to judge their evaluation skills until the guys they're recruiting are 2 or 3 years into their college seasons. I mean, if they're offering a guy, I'm not going to sit here and say that's a bad offer. I mean, those guys know more about football than I do. So I'm not. You can't judge their evaluation until later. He says, also, on the offers, do you feel they are all committable offers, or are they managing the offers to some degree? I don't think they're all committable. I think some of them are what I would call ceremonial designer offers to let you know, hey, we like you. Don't hate us just because you don't have an offer from us. But we'll get back to you, and then they might not get right back to him. But then there's some guys that they're on all the time. So they've got different levels because you can't have 100 offers out. And maybe you would take 100 of them, but you can't, right? So he says, what is your best guess on the timing for a quarterback commitment and who might that be? You know, Cora and I talked about this on the Recruiting Wrap podcast last week. And, you know, going back and looking at Hampton Faye's video, you know, he's been on campus. Michigan State liked him. He liked Michigan State. Will he look around a little bit more? Now Michigan State has offered, or they've been involved with Caden Salter. They've offered some other guys. Will Hampton Faye see that? And if he really likes Michigan State, might that make him antsy to want to go ahead and commit? I don't know, but Hampton Faye at 6'5", he's got good wheels, a quick release for a big dude. He doesn't have a big arm circle like you usually see on big guys. Looks like it processes pretty well. You know, so a lot of those ingredients are there. I think Michigan State really likes him, and he's been to campus, and he likes Michigan State. Those are there. Now, the fourth ingredient, does he like Michigan State enough to go ahead and commit right now? I don't know that. But I would think of all of those guys, he might be the one most likely. And as commitments take place, are guys going to get antsy and not want to lose their place in musical chairs? That could always happen. That's the way the dominoes work. There's just a comment there that I was reading. I got a little distracted by something. So some of those ingredients are there for Hampton Faye. When it'll all come to fruition for any of them, I don't have a real good feel on that right now. But I'll check in with Corey. Maybe we'll have a recruiting wrap here pretty soon. Corey does a great job on the bunker keeping us posted because those things are changing every day. Matt from Hastings, Michigan, who says that he is from Hastings, the birthplace of Gordon Johncock, 2-time Indianapolis 500 winner. I know that, Matt. You don't have to tell me that about Gordy. I know all about Gordy. Might have been born in Hastings, but he called Coldwater, Michigan, his home. I know about Johncock. I know about that Wildcat chassis he had. Was it the chassis or the engine? When he and Andretti, well, no, he won it the year. He had the same car that Andretti had when Andretti got mixed up in that accident on the first lap with Kogan. Was it Kevin Kogan? lap number one, Andretti thought he had a real good chance to get over his bad luck and win that year. Had the same exact car as John Cock. Andretti got taken out by Kogan. Kogan was up in the front row that year. John Cock went on and won. That's back when the Indy 500 was a big deal. And if you guys that are 45 years old and older would remember that, there was a time when the Indy 500 was the biggest American sporting event of the spring. Bigger than the NBA Finals. If you can believe that. Not anymore. All right, so he says, Matt from Hastings says, do you think Maggers have unrealistic expectations for recruiting from this staff? Last week you were asked how soon before we get a five-star recruit. A lot of this hype came with our courtship of Vince Morrow, along with, which didn't pan out. And he says, had Michigan State landed Morrow or perhaps Klinkscale, I would be more optimistic about a quicker recruiting turnaround. So that's an interesting comment from Matt from Hastings. I don't disagree. As far as five stars, well, I don't know what, I can't really speak to what the fans are expecting. I've not seen anything that's too overzealous. I do think that there's going to be more four stars in this class and in the future. What is more four stars? Well, if you look at the rivals rankings, last year Michigan State in 2020, the current 2020 class with Darius Snow, who was a four-star and then he's not, Michigan State signed 4 four-stars. The year before in 2019, 4 four-stars. The year before in 2018, 5 four-stars. The year before in 2017, 4 four-stars. So it's like a 4 four-star recruiting class trend. I'm expecting more than 4 four-star recruits in most classes. I would expect more than 4 this year, and then, you know, well more than 4 in the years ahead. That's just what I'm expecting. Maybe you think I've got unrealistic expectations, but you're wondering, do fans have unrealistic expectations? That depends on what your perception of what the expectations are. What's your perception of the expectations? My perception is the expectations are not crazy high. I think people are pleasantly entertained by the recruiting aggressiveness and expecting improvement in some areas, and I think that's going to happen. So I think they're right on. I don't think anybody's expecting Michigan State to go out and recruit like Ohio State right now. I don't think anyone's expecting that. Do I think Michigan State's going to go out and beat Michigan for in-state recruits in the next 36 months? Yes. Yes, I do. All right, question number 8 from AO3, out of parts unknown. He says, any word on future jobs for Dave Warner, Brad Salem, Mark Staten? No, I've not heard anything. Dave Warner, I don't know if he's going to retire, semi-retire or not, but he's moved out of town. Somebody posted that. He's in Georgia now. I had heard Brad Salem had some interest in some analyst jobs, but I've not heard anything. It's a tough time for those guys. I mean, Terry Samuel got a job at UNLV, but it's a tough time of year to find a job opening because there are no job openings in February. All right, 9 Mile High. Oh, this is question number 9 from a guy named Mile High. From Golden, Colorado, I hope that you're drinking some Coors tonight, sir. He says, anything new to report on Aikens and Bufkin's recruitments? We've gotten into that a little bit already. Anything new on the Christie timeline and status? No, you know, that's an interesting one. You get Brooks, so now what does Michigan State do with Christie? I know they love him, and they always have. They've got a great rapport with his parents, and they like his parents, and they think his parents are sane, good, sane people, which is not always the case in recruiting. You never know where guys are, where parents' heads are some days. And that's not just for recruits. I mean, any of you that have been around Little League Baseball know that there's a lot of crazy parents out there. But they love Christie. So I'm trying to find out. I'll make some calls. But my thought is that they've liked Christie so much that there's always going to be room for Christie. Now, is there room for Bufkin too? Boy, I don't know. These are tough questions. They love Christie, though. No news on that one. He says, how about Damon Payne? Damon Payne, the number one player in the state, football, defensive tackle, and a good one, quick and strong, and hands from Belleville. You know, he's been looking like a South type of guy, maybe an Ohio State type of guy. But nothing new in the last few days. Corey Robinson had some information in the Recruiting Rap podcast indicating that Michigan State was getting a foot in the door there. Doesn't mean that Michigan State's going to become a leader anytime soon, But once travel restrictions are opened back up, do we expect Michigan State could get a visit from him and some serious consideration? Would not shock me. If they play football this fall, Michigan State has a good season. That could help. I don't know if they're going to play good football. I don't know if they're going to play football. I don't know if Michigan State's going to play good football. That schedule is tough. We know that. That'd be one good thing. If they move football to the spring, let's say they take the schedule and they play it March, April, May. So let's say the season starts March 10th. I don't know about you, but I'll bring the Miami Hurricanes up here on March 10th. Come on up. I think Miami's played three cold weather bowl games in the last like 10 years, and they quit in all of them. Just turn the switch off and quit. Once against Notre Dame, it was in the Sun Bowl, and it snowed a little bit. They got beat like 48-0. Quit. Once was the Gator Bowl, and it's a cold weather game. Yeah, it was like 49 degrees. Remember that? They played Wisconsin in the Gator Bowl. I think that was the year Michigan State played probably Georgia in the Capital One Bowl. And 49 degrees, and they're like freezing. They're like, they had a heater on the sideline, and they're huddled around it, and they quit in that game, and Wisconsin handled them. There was one other one. Did they play in the Pinstripe Bowl against somebody? Let me see here. I think they did, and I think it was unseasonably warm. 2018. Yeah, Miami played in the 2018 Pinstripe Bowl. They lost to Wisconsin 35-3. Just quit. And I don't think it was that cold that day. Just quit. So, March 10th, March 11th, they want to play a game at Spartan Stadium against the Hurricanes. Might even be worth waiting. I don't want to say that, do I? All right, what was that question? Anything? All right, one more question. This is not about Michigan State. Clausen Bibbins from Clausen, Michigan says, with all the hype around the ESPN Bulls documentary, do you have any personal memories to share regarding the Bad Boys Pistons era? For myself, I finally recall the behind-the-curtain post-game concerts, Otis Day. I don't remember those. Otis Day and the Knights, did they play at the Silverdome? He says, and joining the court storm after dispatching the Celtics. NBA final tickets were $10. Thank you. I'll hang up and listen. All right, we will get to the chat questions here in a moment, but NBA, the old Bad Boys. I talked about this a little bit last week. I was a big Pistons fan when I was, you know, middle school, elementary, high school. Then as they became really good, I kind of evacuated the bandwagon a little bit. The height of my Piston fandom was when they were getting beat by the Celtics in playoff series. As far as memories, pre-Bad Boys, you know, I remember 1985 being a junior in high school, going to the Silverdome to watch them play the New Jersey Nets NBA playoffs. I think the Pistons swept them 3-0 and then lost, I think, to the Hawks. The next round, then the next round of the first, the next year in the first round lost to the Hawks. So then the Pistons had to shake it up a little bit. But I remember being sitting in the end zone for that one against New Jersey in the Silverdome. And you're right, tickets were, I think they were affordable. We didn't have the $10 up in the third level, but it was one of those deals when you're a junior in high school and it's one of the first excursions driving with kids you went to elementary school with, and now we've got cars, right? That's what I remember about that one. But I remember 1984, I was at a basketball camp, like before 10th grade, at the Hoosier basketball camp in Lake James, Indiana, whatever it's called down that way, northern Indiana. And Doc Rivers came in and spoke to the campers and did some clinics and stuff like that. And somebody asked him about the trade. I think the Pistons had traded Cliff Levingston to Atlanta, and Atlanta had given up Dan Rounfield. And I just remembered Doc Rivers. Let me double check this to make sure Rivers was on that Atlanta Hawks team. That's the way I remember it. Atlanta Hawks 83-91. Yeah. So Doc Rivers, he was saying, he was like, yeah, you know, the trade. He was like, well, I don't know much about Cliff Levingston, but I'll tell you this. The Pistons are getting one great player in Danny Rountfield. They're getting a great, great player. And I just remember Rivers like repeated that three or four times. You're getting a great player in Dan Rountfield. You could tell that he wasn't really thrilled for Dan Rountfield to leave. Rountfield played for the Pistons once. I think he had gray hair that year. And Rountfield was okay, but didn't make much of a difference and was gone. And he was not part of what became the Bad Boys. But my recollections are like pre-Bad Boys. And Rountfield, Detroit Chadsey, Central Michigan Chippewa was Danny Rountfield. Very good college basketball player. And I think he died tragically in Aruba, drowned while saving his wife. He saved his wife's life and drowned Danny Rountfield. So other things about the Pistons. I remember in high school after baseball practice one day, we were all angry, me and my friends, because we were angry that the Pistons did not draft Sam Vincent. And instead they drafted some guy named Joe Dumars. And we were like, how could they do that? I remember like 1982, another basketball camp story. I was like an eighth grader at Basketball Unlimited at Orchard Lake St. Mary's. Some of you guys from Oakland County might remember those days. And Joe Kopicki was there as a counselor, and he was with the Washington Bullets at the time, and he'd played collegiately at the University of Detroit. Kopicki was there. He coached my team all week. I got to know him a little bit. So that year, as an eighth grader, you know, you look up to him and all that. So when the Bullets came to play at the Pistons, we had tickets down there, me and my dad and my brother-in-law and a couple of my friends. We were down in the front row, and I saw Kopicki coming out of the tunnel and shook hands and pictures and that type of thing. So that's pre-Bad Boy stuff. Back then, they had Isaiah Thomas then, but nobody else. I mean, they may have had Lambeer by then, but, you know, you had Kent Benson and, you know, Terry Tyler, who I really liked, and John Long, who I really liked. But and they may have had Vinnie Johnson. They may have gotten Vinnie Johnson around that time. So those are my Bad Boy memories. Once they got really good, I was at Michigan State. I remember the night that, you know, Dantley had the collision. Like, Dantley and Dumars bashed heads, and they lost that game to the Celtics. I was at the Holden Hall that night. I was over on the sister floor with some girls watching the game. There were girls over there watching the Pistons. It was a big deal. But I wasn't as into it by that time. I mean, I was into it in high school, Pistons. But once they got, like, real close, I wanted them to win that one. But also, I remember walking down the hallway the day that when Bird stole the ball? Bird stole the ball underneath the DJ, lays it in. Celtics win that one. I remember I was in the lounge at Holden Hall down on the first floor watching it, and there's a lot of people in there, 30 or 40 people in the lounge area, and I was like in the back because you couldn't get any closer to the TV watching it, and the game is over. So I'm like, I walk out of the rear, and from the rear to the front, there's like a wall and like some you're looking through like, I don't know, like almost like lattice or something. So I'm walking. This game's over, man. Pistons, I can't believe, man. The Pistons are going to beat the Celtics. They're going to win this thing. They're going to the finals. The Pistons are going to the finals. I can't believe. And I'm walking. I think I got like a Diet Pepsi, you know, or Pepsi or something. There might be some added refreshments in there. So I'm walking. And as I'm walking, it's lattice, and you just hear groans. Oh, and I didn't. So I'm walking to see what happened. So at that moment when Isaiah threw it away and Bird stole the ball underneath the DJ, lays it in, I had left and had lit my victory cigar and was walking and just barely got a look at it, which is similar to what happened when it was my fault when Steve Smith missed the free throw against Georgia Tech, because I announced that I was opening my victory beer right as he's shooting that free throw to friends of mine at my house. So both of those were my fault, losing to Georgia Tech in the Sweet 16 and Bird stole the ball. Both my fault. So those are my Bad Boy injury thoughts. That's too much on that. We're about ready to wrap this up. Let's go through these questions here in the chat area. Talking about Harrison and Detroit Renaissance. Greg McGovern, old Tuck says. Okay. Better tight end, Deion Sims or Kellen Davis? That's a good one. Good question. I'd have to really look at the numbers and go back and look at film. Off the top of my head, I'm going to think Kellen Davis, but Deion was pretty smooth for a big dude. John Schick says, Comp, I love that you don't cuss and keep it cool. Keep doing what you're doing. You're the best. Thank you. Aren't there? There's too much it's so mainstream now, the vulgarity that's out there. And I'm not a saint, but I'm listening to like the Sports Illustrated, what used to be Sports Illustrated, the Sports Illustrated media podcast, which should be pretty straight-laced, I would think. And this is before they went through their ownership change and whatever's happened to Sports Illustrated since then. I'm talking like the old Sports Illustrated. The dude that runs that podcast is on there swearing like a sailor. I'm like, Sports Illustrated? That's the old Sports Illustrated. But still, I mean, I'm holding them to the old Sports Illustrated standard, but no further comment on that. Now, what are some of these other ones? I lost my spot. Hayden Fisher says, I'd have to say Forbes, too. Thought he was Europe-bound, and he would have been good European pro, obviously. But, yeah, I agree. I thought Europe for him. And Lansing, who do you think is warming up to us for the next football commitment? Oh, that already answered that. I already answered that question. Rich Fate says, surprised Malik McDowell didn't make it, sort of. In the NFL? Yeah, sort of. Hayden Fisher says Malik always had some attitude issues. Yes, he did. Doors Fan 91 says Jarrell Worthy was a guy who I was surprised didn't stick. I would agree with that too. Hayden Fisher says always wished Langford got another shot after the Bears cut him. That's a good point. Jeremy Langford, the running back. I'm kind of surprised. The words NFL, the acronym NFL stands for not for long, right? Not for long. The minute you lose a little bit as a running back, here we go. Mundy Sking says, I agree about Lithicum. He definitely had a lot of tools to be a solid pro tight end after his senior year. The Beer Ranking Show says, shout out, my bad. Spartans Forever says, remember to hit the thumbs up below the video. Helps Jim. Thank you for that one. Terrence Gibson says, hey, Jim, Terrence from OKC. I'm curious. What do you think about Ohio State's dominance in the Big Ten since 2017? Seems like there is less parity than there was 5 years ago, and I worry Michigan State can catch up. And I worry if Michigan State can catch up. Terrence Gibson, I agree 100%. And the first question of the podcast tonight, I dealt specifically with that point. Ohio State has been like this to the rest of the Big Ten, and it's just taillights. It's just more and more. They are checking out. And as long as Ryan Day can continue with quality control at the Ohio State level, at the Urban Meyer level, and that's a big if, but if he can do that, then they're gone. And can Michigan State catch up? Michigan State can do a lot of things, but I don't foresee Michigan State having the type of talent that Ohio State has had. I don't see them having the top three draft choices in a locker room, 1, 2, and 3, like they had last night. I understand that Burrow went to LSU, but at one point that locker room had the top three picks. Michigan State can do a lot of things, but if Michigan State hits their head on their potential as a program, and maybe we don't know what that potential is. If Tucker gets rolling and stays, I assume he'll stay, I don't know what that could look like. I don't know. So maybe I'm underselling what the ceiling of potential is, but I don't see where the ceiling of potential is where Ohio State is right now and headed to. Ohio State could still be better. Fields, you're bringing back Fields now. I just, catching Ohio State is not, Michigan State's coaches are going to plan to do that. That's what they set out to do, and God bless them for having that. That's the way they should think. But to me, it's almost less about catching Ohio State at that level to more than maxing out what you are and then hoping Ohio State loses a little bit of air in their tires. That's my outlook. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I'm underselling them. I don't know. But as far as the up north today, mentioned that about Ernest Hemingway a little bit ago. I just got that. Just starting to think summer. And now we got a chance to go out. You know, they lifted the restrictions a little bit. I've not been in another building other than my house. I've been outside, but I've not been in another building since March 11th, when I picked up my son at hockey practice. I've not been inside another building. So I'm just working at home, having a good time with my kids, the wife. Everything's great. I know it's not great for everybody. We're thinking about you guys for sure. We've been blessed that things are good so far. I hope things get better for everybody else. I hope everything is good so far for everybody else that's listening and so forth. But with a little bit of the restrictions here in the state of Michigan being lifted a little bit, I wore the up north shirt because I'm starting thinking about the summer and getting up north a little bit. And that's what we do in the state of Michigan. A lot of people like getting up there. I know the people that are up north, they don't want us up there. And I can respect that. They'd like to keep things distance a little bit. I've seen some articles from some of the business owners in Mackinac a little bit are like, yeah, we're okay for a little bit. So anyway, I love it up there. Smelling summer a little bit today, so I got that. But it's great to go up there in the winter too. But anyway, that's why I wore that. Now, Adamificus says, hey comp, how do you feel about the new staff pursuing recruits already committed to other schools? Seems to be a necessary evil nowadays. I would agree with that. And they're just out there trying to bull in a china shop it a little bit. And someone who's committed this early, I mean, things could look a lot different by December, right? So they're just casting some lots with some of these guys. Detroit Spartan talking about where? Correct. Shannon Brown class? Correct. Detroit Spartan says Paul was a good shooter. Lorbeck leaving hurt him big time. Detroit Spartan? Correct, correct, correct. Joker, joker, joker. Detroit Spartan. He's not messing around here. Chris Trainum says, nailed it, Detroit Spartan. I would agree. Chris Trainum says, Mall 286, fresh off of Zoom happy hour. Probably so. Detroit Spartan, Kyle Brown had a good career. I agree with that also. Detroit Spartan, good kid. I agree with that also. Last week, Big Movie led the game and led the Spartan Mag live in scoring and in points. Tonight, Detroit Spartan making all the good points. Detroit Spartan says, yep, Kyle Brown played 202 to 205. 2005 did not play for D'Antonio. Thank you. Chris Trainum said, solid points comp. I still started following the Mag when Kyle Brown was at MSU. Eric, not very frustrating player. Yes, Detroit Spartan, not was a trip at times. Detroit Spartan says, same with his buddy, Damon Dowdell. Can't argue with that. Chris Trainum says, laughing out loud, John L. Smith, not impression. Did you like that? Okay. Detroit Spartan, Detroit Henry Ford boys. Yes. Chris Trainum says, Trowick was Rather Hall incident, was in it, sadly. Yes. Had a hell of a career. Correct, he says. John Schick says, comp, I love that you don't cuss. Keep it cool. Keep doing what you're doing. I think I already read that. And I've already read these. Old Tuck with Greg McGovern. Jason R. says, How would Raekwon Williams not be higher on the draft boards? Jason R. asks. Great question. You know, at this time last year when Raekwon Williams was on the draft boards, they had him as like a second or third rounder, so he might be going pro or something. Didn't go pro. Comes back, and he falls on the draft boards. Now, the draft boards are just mock drafts. People put those together based on some indication that they might or might not have from general managers. So Raekwon Williams, might he go in the third or fourth round? Might he go undrafted? I don't know, because they're not going to tell us. The general managers and scouts are not going to tell us. As of right now, Raekwon Williams, not that high on the draft boards. But again, we're guessing what other people are guessing. But to your point, good athlete, great kid. He's going to work hard, fundamentally sound. I'm not an expert on what it takes to put together an NFL championship roster. It's not something I study a lot. But I agree with you. I would have thought Raekwon Williams was an NFL defensive lineman all along. Chris Trainum says, Hairston and Crawford played nights on the Breslin that year. Great game. I agree. Tom Coyle says, glad I made it. Happy Thursday from Palatine, Illinois. Tom, it's not Thursday, my man. And I think I had you pegged for Oakland County last week, but you're correcting me and saying Palatine, Illinois. Okay. Brad Latch says, with all of the Ohio State commitments in past years, this may have helped us. Does this help us this year with Mel Tucker? He seems to have a very national approach to recruiting. That's a good point. I've not thought about that yet. Ohio State is filling up, leaving Ohio kids behind. In the past, D'Antonio has done a really good job in the state of Ohio. Tucker is serious about Ohio also. That's his home state. He's recruited there in the past for the Buckeyes. So they were there. I mean, Ohio is a priority for this staff, but it might not be the security blanket that it became for the previous staff. Was it 2 years ago that D'Antonio signed like 9 guys from Ohio? And they're good players and they've done well there. And they had a good run. But you know, the current class is not, the current staff is not going to be expecting, I don't think, to go and get nine guys from Ohio and use it as a security blanket per se. Ohio State going off and getting those, does it leave more in the state of Ohio? Yes. Can Michigan State go in there and get some? Yes. Is Kentucky going to be in there? Yes. Michigan, they're going to have to, I'd imagine. So, yes, it helps. Can this staff capitalize? They'll be in it. I've not looked real closely at Ohio recruiting yet. And it's too bad also the T-shirt camps. Usually we'd go to a rivals camp down in Cincinnati or Cleveland, and I'd get a better feel for what's going on in Ohio. Won't be able to do that this year, regrettably. Let's see. Spartans Forever says, that's my concern. I think Tucker and the staff will definitely out-recruit Coach D's staff in terms of stars, but can they evaluate, identify hidden gems, and develop like Coach D did will be interesting. I agree. That's going to be interesting. That's going to be all of it. That'll be the whole shooting match. And if they do, I mean, Michigan State's got some power there. Hayden Vischer says, Ohio Spartan over the mags saying he expects two commitments this week. All right, I'll have to talk to him and find out the information on that, and we'll take a look at it. Grigsby, Brantley, possibly. Yeah, I think Brantley's in there. Gruff Sparty helmet. Once, maybe. Once. Not an every year thing. Once. I don't know what game that would be for. I don't know. I kind of halfway expected for the... What anniversary was it for the Rose Bowl team? Or even the Lorenzo White game, the Hall of Fame? I half expected to see this one get trotted out there. Now, this is not so great, but when you combine it with that, now that's unique, right? I think that's good fun. Never saw that one, though. McCracken Basketball Camp in Lake James, Indiana. Sounds like Doors fan knows that place. Oh, it's called the McCracken Basketball Camp now. But back when I went to that camp, back 75 years ago, it was called the Hoosier Basketball Camp. But at some point, I think Indiana University made them take it down, and it became the McCracken Basketball Camp. And yes, the guy that ran the camp back then was Branch McCracken's son, who at that time was in his 70s, and a glorious old dude. And that was a lot of fun. That was serious. Tough basketball. That was great. It's good times. Detroit Spartan says, I would hammer Ohio on the recruiting trail. I like Detroit Spartan style. Hayden Vischer says, if there's no high school football season, that really sets the next three classes back potentially. No question about it. It'll set them all back nationwide. Be interesting if Michigan does not have high school football, but let's say Wisconsin does. Michigan's always been a little bit, has been better than Wisconsin in high school football. But if you do that to an entire group, what does that do nationally? Wow. Haven't really thought about that. I'm not anticipating high school football in Michigan this year. I could be wrong. They're all waiting. They're taking their cues from, I heard Jeff Kimmerly from the MHSAA on Tim Stout's show this week. And he said, you know, they're taking their cues from the state, obviously. They're not going to be making any decisions. They don't know where things are headed. But I've not thought about that. What if some states have it and some states don't? That'd be interesting. Noah Conley says, how likely is Caden Salter, quarterback to Michigan State? How likely? He's the guy from Texas, runs around pretty well. I'd like to see Caden. I hope he gets a chance to put on some senior film because I want to see him make more reads. Boy, he's slippery back there, scramble to run, good arm angle, creative. I'd like to see him come off his first read and move safeties with his eyes a little more. Maybe he'll do that as a senior. A lot of potential there, though. Michigan State, I mean, he's not visited Michigan State yet. In this era, we are seeing people commit without making official visits. I've not gotten any indication that he was close to making a decision in terms of his chances. You know, Corey Robinson was talking about that Arkansas was the big competitor there, and Arkansas got a commitment from a different quarterback. So in the meantime, you've got Auburn and Baylor in there. Auburn's pretty serious. Tennessee's offered, but Tennessee is in on other quarterbacks. Utah was in on him. Of course, they've gotten a commitment already. So the question is when? I'm not sure. Does Michigan State like him more than Hampton Faye? Only they know. But it's interesting to watch that jockeying going on. Hayden Fisher says the Kelly Green would be sweet even for one game. That'd be interesting, right? I mean, I like Michigan State's darker, kind of the forest green or whatever they call that now. The old Kelly Green, they had some real good teams in that and whatever. And if you're of a certain age, you might like that better. But I think the darker green's been a really great move for them in recent decades. Going back to it once, that'd be interesting. You know, the shade of green, I never thought about that. I'm just talking about more the helmet design, blank on one side, Spartan S on the other. But the shade of green, you make a good point. I don't like that shade of green, my man. Seems kind of cheap. Don't get mad at me, old Tuck, and some of you guys. Like Jolton Joe, if I would say that around him, that the old green looked kind of cheap, dude would come at me, choke slam me. So nobody take any swings at me or anything. That's just my opinion. I think Michigan State was smart to do what they've done with that shade of green. I don't understand. Caden, unless Chris Trainum says at Hayden Fisher, he's talking with Hayden Fisher, potentially since no tape from this high school season, but who knows? All to be determined. Hayden Fisher says maybe Rivals can hold a t-shirt camp during Christmas break. That's a hell of an idea. I'm going to pass that along. I wonder if they've thought of that. Brian Scilacci says, other backcourt options out there besides Mane? Not that I'm aware of. Not that I'm aware of right now. Salter did a virtual visit with Michigan State. Good point, Carter, 917. I forgot about that. I got the memo on that, and then I forgot. That's interesting, though. That is interesting. That's not meaningless. Come on, Comp. The throwback unis are in, Hayden Fisher says. Jolton needs to be medicated. Detroit Spartan is correct about that, too, and we're going to wrap it up on that point. Detroit Spartan was about 9-0 today. Give Hayden Fisher credit. The throwback unis are in. All right, I'll give you credit on that. Throwback unis are in. They are. So that would be throwback for Michigan State, for sure. Of course, they did that commemorating the 1966 game in, was it 2006? 2006? Anyway, hey, appreciate everybody. All right, Doors fans saying Fleck and Chiano took pay cuts today, temporary, and I assume they'll make it back. Interesting about Fleck. Interesting. Years from now. This is, you guys hate it when I do this. Years from now, I'll tell you a PJ Fleck thing. Sorry. Sorry, and I won't forget it. I'll put it on my notes. I can't say it right now. Can't say it. All right. So anyway, and it's nothing bad about him at all. All right. So anyway, that's going to wrap it up. Detroit Spartan led the league in points tonight for sure. Great job for him. Thank you for chiming in. Thank you for tuning in. Give us a thumbs up. Subscribe. Tell your friends about it. Spartan Mag Live. We've been doing it weekly. Going to try to churn it out a little bit more. Recruiting Rap Podcast. It's on SpartanMag.com from last week. We improved our audio for that. I thought it went really well. The soundboard that I have for that, I want to bring into this for some ideas in the future. We're going to keep growing and make this have some different offshoots of this. And I'm looking forward to it. Anyway, thanks to all the Maggers out there. SpartanMag.com subscribers. We love you guys. Thanks. Hope everybody's safe. And hope everybody's happy and healthy. Have a good time with your family this weekend. Enjoy the draft. Michigan State players should be getting drafted on Saturday. Check the coverage, SpartanMag.com for that. In the meantime, we'll see you next time. From East Lansing, Jim Comperoni, Publisher, SpartanMag.com. Have a great weekend. Thank you.